Father, we thank you so much for this time together, and we just pray for the preaching of your word and the hearing of your word. May you bless us just as your word is being preached, and bless me and help me as I minister to your people. And, Father, what I've prepared, I pray it's a blessing to everyone here. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so if you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Acts chapter 5. Passage this morning is out of Acts 5, verses 12 through 16. Again, it's Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16. It says, "Now many signs and wonders were regularly done among the people by the hands of the apostles, and they were all together in Solomon's portico. None of the rest dared to join them. But the people held them in high esteem. And more than ever, believers were added to the church, multitudes of both men and women, so that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, that as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them. The people also gathered from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing the sick and those afflicted with unclean spirits, and they were all healed." Praise God for his word. All right, so this is a pretty neat passage that we have today. I think some see it in a different light. If you have a conservative view, you're kind of skeptical about what you're reading. If you are more charismatic, you happily love this passage. We need to be somewhere in between, right, so to speak. I think that when we talk about signs and wonders, there's a lot of confusion there within the Christian church. Again, it goes back to basically what religion you are and, what your conviction is about signs and wonders. But we're going to try to stay genuine and true to what the Word of God says here and focus on this passage and try to understand what these signs and wonders, not only what they were, but also the purpose behind them. First of all, we have to realize that the Holy Spirit is the one at work here. And the Bible describes the Holy Spirit as the wind, or like the wind. No one knows where it's going and no one knows what it's going to do. That is the deep lesson behind the Holy Spirit. And the purpose of this book, and thankfully the purpose of this book, is it allows us to see the work of the Holy Spirit. And we get to see the mystery of who he is and what he does and why he does it. And so that's the wonderful thing about this book, the book of Acts. It shows us the power of the Holy Spirit as he moves in the lives of the early church. There is no other book like this that describes his movement who he is as a person, or shows us who he is as a person. When something miraculous happens today, that's how we know it's the Holy Spirit. Well, we know because, first of all, that's the faith that has been given to us by God. But also, we know it is the Holy Spirit, and we recognize his work because we can point back to the book of Acts and say, "Oh yeah, I've seen that before. I've read that before. That's encouraged me before." So that's the importance of this book here that we read today. Well, today's passage describes the amazing work of God done among the people of that time through the hands of others. When we compare this passage about the early church to today, the Spirit shows us that God still does amazing work. He still does even today. So the sermon summary is this: the Holy Spirit still ministers to us today by the grace of God and through the hands of others. We can be encouraged by that. Let me say it again. The Holy Spirit still ministers to us today by the grace of God and through the hands of others. Let me establish the context for you and then we'll move on from there. Verse 12, that serves as a summary of the events that took place within the early life of the church. Basically, when you read this passage, You can read verse 12 and then you can put everything else in parentheses because everything else is referring back to verse 12. So in other words, the details are in verses 13 through 16. Verse 12 is the summary. The details are in verses 13 through 16. Now, first, we have to understand Luke's historical account of the early church as it picks up right after, immediately after, Ananias and Sapphira. So last week, the story ended with both of their deaths and because of sin. And it shocked the church, right? So the church became fearful of the apostles. Look at verse 11. And great fear came upon the whole church and upon all who heard of these things. So the word fear is, when we read it in the Bible, sometimes it's about reverence, and then other times it's about terror. Well, here, people were terrified. It wasn't like they had this holy reverence. It was, I'm scared of the apostles. I am fearful. I am terrified of them, so to speak. So Peter, in that account, proclaims the guilt on Ananias and Sapphira, and then they drop dead. And after that, everybody was terrified. And imagine, Peter probably didn't have any more friends after that. You can't get too close to Peter, or else you'll just drop dead, because sooner or later, he's going to see some sin in you. So now, we pick up from there. Now we see that many other signs and wonders were regularly done, it says. People were being healed of sicknesses and of they were being exercised of demons, and yet the people were still afraid of the apostles. And what's key to notice here is that this fear that they had of the apostles, it should sound familiar to us. Because if we go back to the Gospels and we read about Christ and the amazing work he did, the disciples were with him, and all the others who were with him, what did it say? It said that they were terrified. They were scared of his power that he executed in front of them. So that's the same type of picture that we have here. The people are fearful of the apostles. Well, it makes sense. Why? Because Christ, the same power they saw in Christ, is working in the apostles. They're doing things that they're not supposed to be doing. So they weren't fearful because they were scary men or evil men. They were just powerful men. So it was a power they had never seen before. I remember as a kid growing up, like if, you know, we were about to play a really good football team, right? And we weren't a good football team. And you see the other guys across the field, and they're huge. And they're jump high, and they run fast, and they look like your uncle and your dad instead of the you know, a person your age. You're going to go on that field, and you're going to be thinking twice about your opponent. You're going to be fearful, so to speak, because of the power they seem to possess. I use that as an example. That's not exactly equal to the way people saw Christ, because, again, he was doing things only God did. So you could see how they would be terrified of that power. So then, again, now we fast forward to this time. The apostles are doing the same works that Christ was doing, and the people were fearful of them. But here's the important part of the passage, at least for us today. Verse 12 mentions three things, and really four things. But the fourth thing I'll mention at the very end. But the three things that I really want to focus on today is the fact that it talks about many signs and wonders were regularly done. That's something I want to talk to you about. They were done among the people. That's another point of importance here. And then they were done by the hands of the apostles. And then if you want to add the last one, the last point here is that they gathered together. They were together. So let's talk about the signs and wonders. Well, the signs and wonders being performed were divine acts carried out by the Holy Spirit. We have to establish that first and foremost. It would be wrong for us to look at Peter, John, James, Andrew, any of them, right, and say, wow, these men were special. on their own. These men were they were saints. These men were holy people, and that's why they were able to do these things. Those men were like they were like you and I. They were sinful men in need of a savior, plain and simple. So the work that they're doing is being done by the Holy Spirit. Just like the work that you do when you do good works for God is being done by the Holy Spirit. We can't take any credit for it, and they'd be the first to tell you, this was not done by me. I was merely the vessel. This is the work of God in me. So that's one thing that we have to make certain of right away. We're talking about Christ here. We're not talking about saints. We're not talking about holy men. We're not talking about that. They didn't have this power to do signs and wonders within themselves. So that's the very first thing that we have to establish. But these signs and wonders were unexplainable and unimaginable. They broke the laws of nature, of physics. They were just, when they were done, no one could explain them. No one could understand how it happened. And these things weren't temporary things where it lasted like a couple of seconds. The things that the apostles were doing, they were healing people. They were exorcising demons. This lasted a lifetime. So these are people who couldn't see, couldn't walk, couldn't do things. And no medicine was given to them. They were prayed for. Our Peter's shadow passed by them. And then all of a sudden, their life changed forever. They could do what they couldn't do before. Today, we would say that's a miracle. And we would be right. That's a miracle today. When the doctor says, I can't explain it, but you're healed, that's a miracle. See, we sometimes don't look at it the same way. We want to see Pastor Shadow pass by me and heal me. That's what we want to see. I'd like to see that too. I think that'd be pretty cool. But it's not going to happen. What's going to happen is that God's going to move in an extraordinary way in your life, the way he chooses to move. And so if the doctor tells you you have cancer one day, then you go back and you don't have cancer, we say praise be to God. And then I can take it even further than that. If you have cancer one day, then you go back to see the doctor the next day, and the doctor says the cancer is worse, and then that person ends up dying, what do we say? Praise be to God, he or she is healed if they are in Christ. Right? Because that's the most miraculous thing that happens to us after we die, is the fact that we continue to live in the grace of God. And that we are restored in every way after we die. So then when someone dies of a disease or a sickness, we don't say, oh, the disease won or the sickness won. We say Christ has victory over death. That's what we say. So when the doctor says, I can't explain it, but you're healed, or when your spouse returns from a broken relationship or a marriage, when that one person you've been praying for all these years comes to Christ. Those are all things that we might see as, well, those are regular things. No, those are not, brother and sister. They're not regular things. Those are miraculous things. They are done by the Holy Spirit. So what does that show us? It shows us that God, he was at work in the book of Acts here in chapter 5, verses 12 through 16, but he's still at work today. We just have to see it with the right eyes. We have to see it through the eyes of faith. These things were regularly done with, so that the people would see the power of God and that the power of God would open their ears to the word of God. Well, when you look at this passage, there is no coincidence that there are a record number of people who are being added to the church. And that's saying things because there have been thousands of people already added up to this point. It's like every time Peter preaches, there's thousands of people who come to Christ. But here, the Bible talks about there even being more than before. Why? Because people are seeing the power of God, and they're saying, there is a God. He does know me. He is involved in his creation. And then that opens up their minds and their ears to what God has to say to them. So those are the signs and wonders that are being done. They're real then, they're real now. But the Bible says that they were done among the people. Well, it's tempting for us to call these people lucky. That's one habit I've been trying to break myself of. That's something that we use all the time. We use that word lucky. Oh, you're lucky. Or, oh, they're lucky, right? And we don't really mean it because we believe in the sovereignty of God, but I just need to get that out of my vocabulary. So if you hear me say it, you can call me out on it, okay? But we want to say that these people are lucky, but we shouldn't, because luck happens by chance. We say we serve a sovereign God. There is no such thing as luck. Instead, these people were targets of God's mercy. They were targets of God's mercy. So, in other words, God looked down and he saw that person suffering. And God blessed that person. Why? Because he knows us by name. He knows the number of hairs on our head. And he blessed that person with that miracle at that time. That person was blessed by God because he was, or she was, a target of his mercy and his grace. And let me tell you something, God never misses his target. God purposely moved in the lives of these people to bring about his will for their lives. God worked in two ways, because these signs and wonders, they caused two different things to happen. They were either physical in nature or they were spiritual in nature. People were healed of sicknesses. That's the physical side. People were, they were relieved of demonic oppression. That's the spiritual side. So the people of that day saw God moved in mighty ways. Well, let's compare it to today. God still restores physical health. Still. There are so many people in here who could say, yeah, I can testify to that. God restored my health. But everyone who's a Christian here can say this. Yes, God saved me from demonic oppression. Right? Because we were being oppressed by the enemy. We were enemies of God, but friends with the enemy. And then God saved us. He saved us from that oppression. And we might look at that and we might think that's a small thing. No, that's the best thing, the most powerful thing that ever happens to a person. For many in here, God has already freed us from the oppression of evil. Listen to this out of Colossians chapter 1, verse 21 through 23. And you, who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, that's us, we can take that personal, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. If indeed you continue in faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard. We are righteous because of Christ. God has healed us of many sicknesses and diseases and oppression for us to be where we are at today. I can look around this room and I can tell you stories about the people who have been healed and how they were just miraculous. Sister Esther seems to have 9 lives, or at least 9 chances. That lady just continues to exist. She continues to live by the grace of God. This is past week. A sister brought a praise report thanking God for a restoration of health and his continued grace upon her. I look at Pastor David back there. Wonderful to have him with us. Could have been a different story. But then even his healing process now, doctors are amazed by it. There's just so many people who have been touched by God when it comes to their health. But then even more important, I can look around and I can tell you the different stories about how people have been freed of oppression from evil forces, from the power of Satan. Why? Because they saw Christ as their Savior. He's the one who broke the chains and freed them. And now they are free indeed. These things were done to those people, but these things are still done for you. And listen, it's not by chance. When God blesses you, when God does something miraculous in your life, it was for you and you alone. That's how wonderful God is. And then also by the hands of the apostles is the other important part of this passage. Or I'd like to say this, by the hands of the apostles and others. So many signs and wonders were done. They were done among the people by the hands of the apostles. And I want to put in parentheses and others, and I'll explain what I mean. See, the best part of this story is the fact that these divine acts of mercy are being manifested through regular men. That is awesome. Because God could have just done it any way he wanted to. But notice how God always uses fallible men. From the very beginning, when he called Moses, Moses is like, I'm not a good speaker. Please don't pick me. God used regular men to do these extraordinary things. Not that they can get the credit, but that so that he can get the glory. Outside of what Christ has done, this seems to be the pinnacle of signs and wonders in the early church. I mean, come on. Peter's shadow is healing people. Like, really? Remember what Jesus said to the disciples in John chapter 14? He said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do." He told that to the disciples. Now look. They are able to do these things because of the Spirit that Christ has put in them. He prepared them for this. He told them this would happen. And now it's happening. Look at verse 15. "So that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats, that as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them." What does that remind you of? Well, this is similar to the power of Jesus flowing from him when the woman with the issue of blood touched him. It's just the presence of Christ that is healing people. People look at that today and they try to copy that. Manufacture that. People say, "I want to do that." Well, let me say, who wouldn't? I'd like to do that too. It'd be cool just to like make my shadow pass all over you and then all your problems are solved. It's easy to see that it was not the power of Peter doing this, but the power of God. This wasn't something that Peter continued to do either. Right? Because if this was Peter, well, something would tell you that Peter would continue to get stronger as he was sanctified. So then Peter would become like this superhero or this idol that people worshipped. But Peter, when you look at his life, I hate to tell you, but Things got worse for him, not better, from a worldly standpoint. He suffered more. He went through more turmoil. He sinned. Remember in the book of Galatians, Paul had to tell him to his face that he was in the wrong. Because when the Jews came, he went away from the Gentiles because he didn't want to be considered among them. And Peter said, and Paul comes and says, yeah, I had to tell him to his face that he was in the wrong. Peter was a sinful man. He had sinned like you and I. This power did not come from him, or else he would have never have been murdered. He would never have been crucified. So even though Peter was able to do this now, he wasn't always able to do it. We see the same thing in Paul. Paul's doing all these miracles, and at the very end in 2 Timothy, he's hurting. And he's telling Timothy, he didn't tell Timothy, hey, heal yourself of your issue. He says, drink a little wine. Let it help you. Let it minister to you. Take some medicine, in other words. See, God does signs and wonders as he sees fit. And just because God did these specific signs and wonders in the Bible, it doesn't mean that it's going to happen just like it did back then. But that also doesn't mean that the same power isn't at work. God is still at work. But listen, brothers and sisters, the only way you're going to see that is if you see it through faith. That's it. You have to see it through faith. Even the small things. The small things is God at work in your life. How does God work through us who are alive today? Well, when we display acts of mercy towards others. You see, the awesome thing about this is that when God sees you and he answers a prayer and he does a miracle for you, I told you that that's specifically for you. But on the flip side, when God uses you to minister to somebody else, it wasn't an accident that you were the one used for that somebody. God specifically called you to minister to whoever it is that you minister to. And we have no idea how God's going to use what we have done for that person. We may never know, but God knows. And again, remember, God never misses his target. We never know how we're going to be used. Believe me, when I joined this church in 2002 as a youth minister, I never, ever, ever thought that I was going to be an elder here, a pastor here. That didn't even cross my mind. And then fast forward to 2008, whenever I was called as the only pastor here at that time, I never, ever, ever thought I'd be preaching in front of you in 2024. But by the grace of God. I look at people here today and I understand God has called me, and I say me because this is personal, he has called me to minister to all of you through teaching and preaching and counseling and whatever else I have to do. God, there is no accidents. There are no coincidences. God is at work. His Spirit does mighty acts. He does miracles and wonders. And this is what's awesome. He uses you to minister to people. We have to be careful to notice that the apostles weren't the only ones at work here. Let's notice the helping hands that were so important. What do I mean? Well, let's look at the text. Look at verse 15, or we'll back up to verse 14. And more than ever, believers were added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. Verse 15. And so that they even carried out the sick into the streets and laid them on cots and mats. And as Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them. Listen, not everybody could walk. Apparently, none of these people could walk. How did they get to the street so that Peter could pass by and his shadow could heal them? By people picking them up and moving them to that position. What is that a picture of? It's a picture of the church. It's a picture of the church. It's a picture of the pastor ministering, the teacher ministering, the gospel. How do people get here? Because the church invites them. The church says, hey, you're sick. You need somewhere to come. I have the place for you. You're spiritually sick and you need a doctor. Come to church with me. Come and hear the gospel. Or just when someone is going through something and you come and you put your arm around them and you say, hey, what can I help you with? What kind of advice can I give you? What kind of encouragement can I be? It wasn't only the apostles. It was everyone working together, as the passage says. These are the other helping hands that are so important in the life of the church. The Spirit used the apostles to heal, yes. But he also used the others to bring them to the apostles. We are the others. I'm included in that with you. Do not call me an apostle. You and I will have to square up if you call me an apostle. Do not do that. We're the others together. We're doing these what seems like normal, everyday things. Praying for each other. Hey, send a text. Hey, I was thinking about you this morning, just praying for you. That's just like, oh, that's normal. No, it's not. Praying for somebody is not normal. Oh, I'm just reading my Bible today. That's not a normal act. These are things that we get to do because our hearts have been changed. Going to the throne of God is not a normal thing. That's what we do when we pray. We approach the throne of God, asking God to help us in our situation so that his name will be glorified and we will receive the help that we need. This week, I keep on using Pastor David because it's basically the most recent thing that's happened here. But Pastor David sent, we have a text group, the pastors have a text group, and that's how we keep updated, each other updated with everything. And Pastor David sends a picture of the ramp that was built at his house. Did a wonderful job, right? And underneath the ramp that he sent, here's the caption, or this is what he put. He said, the ramp is complete. I have taken a few victory laps up and down. Then he says, words cannot express my gratitude. Thank you all. And I thought, man, that's awesome. But you know something? When I looked at the ramp, I was like, man, that's awesome. That's awesome. You know why? Because every day that Pastor David comes out, even after he starts walking again, every day he comes out of that front door, he's going to see that ramp. And that ramp is not just wood and stone, or it's just not parts. It's not just nails, screws. It's not just an object. He's going to walk by that thing every day. He's going to see the love of God through the fellowship of the saints. That's what he's going to see. What a wonderful gift that he has. But listen, we all have that gift. There are ways that people have ministered to us that can be reminders. Yes, somebody cares about me. Yes, somebody loves me. Yes, I have a community here. There are people who are helping me. A lot of times it's our own fault. We don't open up and we're not honest with people. We don't say, hey, I need help. We expect people just to read our minds. But I would assure you that somewhere in here, if you're struggling with something and you say, I need help, I would be very disappointed that no one did anything for you if you said that. I'd like to challenge you to do that, to see who would say, hey, I have some advice for you. Hey, I have some wisdom. Hey, I can help you with that. But we have to be open to that. And believe me, pastors are the worst people about that. About saying, hey, we need help over here. That's a lesson that I'm still learning. It's very difficult. I'm grateful for the people around me who can kind of look at me and say, man, you look bad. You need some help. Brother Gary back there, I look at him and every now and then he'll say, hey, we need to go to lunch together. That means you look bad. You need to talk. Let's go ahead and have lunch together. Listen, I want you to know. You have to know. God still performs signs and wonders today. They happen by the power of the Holy Spirit. They are divinely appointed for the saints. I'll get more personal. They are divinely appointed for you. They are both physical and spiritual in nature. They are performed through the hands of men. And they are used to strengthen our resolve and increase our faith. And lastly, they bring about the glory of God. God is still at work. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this.